stress-free.
Endangered ecosystems in the world. So there's not many native grasslands left, and those that are left don't really get protected in the same way that the number of elk we have in the park don't have too many. So that doesn't seem likely either. Another reason might be that there was a fire that burned through here recently, and if you look around you can see some kind of charred trees in various spots. So that looks like a winter to me. So yeah, there was a fire that burned through here. I think from Mireille, who took you out on the marsh earlier, she said some of you had some questions about some plants, so I got like a printout with some. She told me to pass this along. So some plants that you're asking about, prairie rose I see is one of them. That's a really beautiful flower that we get. Snowberry, yeah, that's an interesting plant. It was called by the First Nations people ghost berry. It was supposed to be like the spirits of Saskatoon berries. And also they're poisonous, so don't eat them. And then hawthorn. So hawthorn is one of the more popular, where they start their kind of system of tunnels. That black stump there? Yeah, it looks like a bear, but it's... I do that literally all the time. It's like more like a ground squirrel kind of, but similar to a mole. So just this little rodent that burrows all over the prairie. There's kind of two ways to test whether it's an anthill or from if it's from a pocket gopher. First way is you just kick it, and if no ants come out, it's not an anthill. A little more ambitious, just trying to kind of keep up with the neighbors.
So, is it definitely your gopher?
Yeah, so I think these are all from pocket gophers, just kind of not seen. So yeah, these are a couple of skulls. Anybody care to hazard a guess what kind of animal they're from?
Moose.
Good guess, no? There you go. So yeah, these are both from elk. So this is a female elk, this is a male elk, obviously because it has the pedestal here for the antlers. A way that you can tell that they are elk rather than moose is by this little indent they have kind of near the eye there. And that's where they have a scent gland. Elk do, but moose don't. So sometimes you'll see elk kind of like poking themselves in the face by a tree. That's them just activating that gland and kind of marking their territory. Small elk. The male elk, who kind of becomes dominant in the herd, will mate with all of the females. So that's called a harem. Prairie sage is one of the four sacred medicines on the traditional kind of medicine wheel, along with cedar, tobacco, and sweetgrass. Spending the fall eating, building up their fat supply. They'll kind of look for a spot to make a den. If they find a really nice spot, let's say this one, they'll probably dig it out. But they often won't, and so when it starts to get to around the time to start hibernating, snows are starting falling, they'll just kind of wander around, and one day they'll just go like, here's fun, and they'll just kind of lay down.
This is the site of an old bear den. So
bears famously hibernate, or if you're a biologist, they don't. They go into what's called a torpor. Yeah. Pond here, say there was like a very large tree that fell, and this was kind of where its roots was.
You can see the claw marks kind of going up the side of that one too. So that's kind of a fun thing.
The thing too,
just go for vulnerable points on the bear, namely the nose.
But there's one final rule. Always bring somebody that runs over the
wolves. Is usually kind of one the indigenous people here and settlers. It spread really quickly. It's just kind of nice, easy to cook. Keeps pretty well. Very simple to make. It's basically just brown, pretty much.
Oh, that stress-free soap would be well away.
Yeah.
Stress-free.
Look at the wild horses over there.
The illustrious just kind of generally get a bit of a bad rep. If you think of any kind of story with a wolf in it.
National park.
Great.
Turn the bears eating.